You're listening to Conferences Online Allergy from Children's Mercy Hospital in Kansas City, Missouri. Today is August 19, 2019, and I'm your host, Dr. Jay Portnoy. Our topic today, non-IgE-mediated food allergy. Our presenter is Dr. David Stukas. He's an assistant professor of pediatrics in the section of allergy immunology at Nationwide Children's Hospital in Columbus, Ohio.
Okay, well, thank you, Paul, and thanks, everybody, for joining me. I'm going to do my absolute best to finish on the hour as we had scheduled, so we're going to get right to it, if that's okay. These are my disclosures, none of which are relevant, other than the fact that I am a member of the Joint Task Force now, and that's going to come into play because I am going to introduce the new Joint EOE guidelines that we're going to publish, hopefully, sometime this year with the AGA, so we'll get to that in a little bit. And our objectives are really going to talk about the presentation of various non-IgE mediated food allergies, including presentation, testing, prognosis, management, things along those lines. But I'd like to start with a historical reference, because when you think about non-IgE mediated allergies, these were actually first described many, many moons ago by somebody you may be familiar with, Hippocrates. And he noted that cow's milk caused some infants to have symptoms consistent with a non-IgE food allergy, such as vomiting, diarrhea, failure to thrive. And they improved after they took it out of their diet. So this is certainly nothing new that we're dealing with here. And I'd like to start with some general thoughts about how do we approach these patients, because we all get referrals and we all see families that have concerns about their child's eating and the way they go to the bathroom. It's too often, it's not often enough, it's too smelly, not smelly enough, it looks funny, all those things. So we need to start really with a detailed history. And I know everybody in the room and on the call is very familiar with starting with the history as allergists and really going from there. But in addition to that, we also need to understand the prevalence of these diseases, because that's going to lead into our pretest probability, as well as the differential diagnosis, and really taking a patient-centered approach, because we don't always have a clear answer the first time we see these families or these patients, and it requires additional testing, trial and error, sometimes elimination diets, and follow-up. So that's really why we need to focus on communication, shared decision-making, and really an understanding of what we're trying to achieve here. And it's okay to say, I'm not sure what's going on, as long as you have a plan in place. So oftentimes it's, let's try this approach, you discuss the risks and benefits, and then you decide when to reconvene, either by telephone or in the office. And eventually, either kids will outgrow it on their own, or you're going to come to your answer. And I also want to go back to, if your spidey sense is tingling. So you're all really good at identifying IgE-mediated food allergies. Those patients are coming in with a very specific story or a range of stories. And these conditions we're going to talk about today really fall outside that realm. In regards to definition, you're all familiar with this. An allergy is an immunologic response. Every single time you're exposed to the allergen, you should have reproducible symptoms with every exposure. An intolerance is more of a non-immunologic response that really should be gastrointestinally involved, where you can't digest a food. The most common example would be lactose intolerance, or people who are sensitive to FODMAPs, things like that. And then, of course, your familiar IgE is involved in the immediate hypersensitivity response, and the typical symptoms that go with IgE-mediated food allergy are well understood by everybody on the call. I'm going to start with the references. So these are the two references that almost all of my information is going to come from for the purposes of this talk. So I encourage everybody to read these. These are fantastic. I'm going to break it down for you, and I think that this really is a good blueprint for all of us to follow in regards to approaching non-IgE food allergies. If you think about the way that this can impact people, it's mostly going to be gastrointestinal. We're going to talk about most of these, except for celiac, which is not going to be part of today's conversation. You can also have skin symptoms as well, including contact dermatitis, and then very, very rare conditions such as pulmonary hemosiderosis. But we're going to focus most of today's presentation on the GI manifestations. Now, in regards to the pathophysiology, we understand IgE-mediated food allergy fairly well, not necessarily anaphylaxis per se, but in regards to IgE allergy, it's you form a pre-specific or a specific IgE towards an allergen. Every time you're exposed to it, the IgE is already bound to mast cells and basophils. It opens up those cells, releasing preformed mediators, which cause immediate symptoms, which then also send additional signaling to cause late-phase allergic reactors to come to play as well. When it comes to non-IgE food allergies, there's a whole spectrum here. It's going to involve a lot of T cells, especially food allergen-specific suppressor T cells and food protein enteropathies. FPIs is considered a T cell mediated disease as well. But other than that, we really don't have a good understanding of exactly what's going on. And that it's partly why we're going to have a really hard time with specific diagnostic modalities and specific treatment options other than elimination diets as well. Okay, so I want to focus on this because this is the approach that we're going to take for almost every single condition. What's the clinical presentation? We need a detailed history to try to determine what are the symptoms, are they reproducible with every exposure, what are the foods you're worried about. We have to have an understanding of the common foods involved with the non-IgE food allergies, what testing is available, what should be pursued, what should we avoid, what are our management options, and then prognosis as well. So this will be the consistent approach that we take. Let's start with FPIs. This was an updated international consensus guidelines that was just published a couple of years ago. This has wonderful information in regards to the clinical presentation, diagnosis and management, as well as prognosis of FPI. So I encourage everybody to read this if you have time. In regards to the presentation, this is typically something that presents during infancy. It can occur early, especially if they're going to react to formula-based proteins such as soy or milk, or it can be a little bit later once babies start eating solid foods. The most common presentation that we're going to focus on today is the acute FPIs reaction. And everybody's very familiar with this. Symptoms occur 1 to 3 hours after the ingestion. It's not going to be immediate onset. Severe repetitive projectile emesis. Can have diarrhea as well. And then for those who become very ill from these reactions, they can become lethargic and hypovolemic and basically go into shock in the severe cases. And there's also a more chronic form of FPIs that's been described in recent years as well, which is typically going to affect infants that are very young with cow's milk or soy formula, and they can have intermittent but progressive symptoms as well. Now, clues. You really need to have more than one reaction in order to diagnose FPIs. That being said, I've diagnosed FPIs after one reaction in one patient. It happened to be the granddaughter of one of our nurses in the allergy clinic. So she had a very high suspicion at the get-go. And they came in with the most classic presentation of FPIs you can possibly imagine. And we ended up talking about just avoiding it and then reintroducing it. We'll talk about management in a moment. But for everybody else, we really need to have a good story of reproducible symptoms at least twice. Infants are otherwise well in between acute episodes. For those families that come in saying, my child vomits every time they eat, that's not FPIs. When they come in saying they're vomiting to 16 different foods, that's not FPIs. For those who say they had severe episodes on two occasions but then have chronic symptoms in between, that's not FPIs either. And then, of course, also ruling out things like gastroenteritis, other more common comorbid conditions that may be contributing, and then obvious explanations. Now, there are diagnostic criteria that have been proposed that include both major and minor criteria. And in order to meet the diagnosis for FPIs, you have to have at least the major criteria and three or more minor criteria. And this makes sense as we're all familiar with the condition. So the major criteria is you have to have a good story. So you have to have vomiting several hours after ingestion and absence of hives and swelling and itching and other classic IgE symptoms, because you can have delayed presentations as far as an IgE food allergy as well. So we always have to keep that in mind. Minor criteria would include a second episode, at least, of repetitive vomiting with the same food, repetitive vomiting with a different food, if they do have severe symptoms such as lethargy or pallor, if they had to go to the emergency room or receive volume replacement, and also with diarrhea and hypotension as well. So I just want everybody to be familiar with these criteria when you're seeing patients and evaluating them. Now, the most common foods are cow's milk and soy, because they're more formula-based, and that's what infants are going to be exposed to early on. But as they start eating solid foods, we also have to think about rice, wheat, oats. It's also been described to vegetables, fruits, poultry, egg. Essentially, any food could potentially cause FPIs. We're starting to see more and more sort of anecdotal case reports about green pea. Why green pea? Well, green pea is being used more as a substitute for plant-based options. So as we explore more of a plant-based diet, there's a lot more pea protein being used. So infants are being exposed in an earlier basis. So something else to keep in mind. The majority of children will really only react to one food, but you can certainly have FPIs to more than one food as well. So we have to keep that in mind. But this goes back to what I mentioned a couple of moments ago, where if they come in with a very long list of suspected foods, it's unlikely that each and every one of those foods is specifically causing FPIs. And then with FPIs, unlike some of the other conditions we'll talk about, it's very unusual for an exclusively breastfed infant to develop FPIs. They really have to have ingestion of the intact protein in order to cause a symptom. In regards to testing, we don't have a diagnostic test that says this is FPIs. It's a careful history excluding other comorbid conditions or other causes, talking about the reproducible nature of it. Is it a more common food that's been described? You can consider trial elimination diets and reintroduction. We rarely need to progress towards biopsies, and we don't really recommend using patch tests or food-specific IgG testing. A lot of people will do IgE testing more to rule out the presence of an IgE-mediated food allergy, and there's been some recent reports of kids with FPIs actually developing IgE food allergies, and it's a question of, it doesn't seem like it's related, but it's more, is it co-sensitization or they're sensitized while they also have FPIs and they have comorbid conditions, and that really has to be teased out a little bit further. Now, in regards to testing, we talked about IgE tests should be negative. I just mentioned that some of them will have elevated results, but again, is it just because you're going to see that in the general population anyways or not? We don't know. And otherwise, you can have abnormalities during an acute FPIs reaction, which would include leukocytosis, thrombocytosis. They can become acidotic or have evidence of methemoglobinemia as well. As far as management, elimination diet really should resolve symptoms within a few hours for the acute presentation. If it's more of the rare chronic FPIs, you take it out of the diet and symptoms should resolve on their own. And in regards to future reactions, it's really talking about communicating how to avoid the food, how to read labels, and then giving families a letter for if they do have a severe acute episode and they have to go to the nearest emergency room. Most of those emergency room physicians are going to be unfamiliar with FPIs, so it's important to sort of lay out what that looks like. And this is something I've adopted over the last couple of years, and it's supported in the international guidelines as well. Is, you know, we can give them a prescription for ondansetron or antiemetic as well, especially for those kids as they get older and they may have more accidental ingestion or do have more of a mild presentation. We can make them feel better by treating them. This is an example of a letter. You can get this from the FPIES Foundation, and you can adapt it to however you like. This is something that we have in our electronic medical record here at Nationwide Children's, and something that's automatic for every family with FPIES. And really, it just walks through, my child has FPIES, it's a type of allergy, these are the foods they need to avoid, these are the symptoms they can have. And then I like the last paragraph here. Hopefully you can see my arrow on the screen. This information is being given so that this could be considered in the differential diagnosis for my child. In other words, saying, listen, you're the expert, you're the doctor, you're the one acutely evaluating my ill child. I want you to know that they have FPIs, but don't be a fool. So if they have symptoms that are consistent with another condition, treat them accordingly. And at the same time, it also says, don't give them epinephrine because that's not going to help either. So I'm sure this is something you're all familiar with at your institution as well. Now, in regards to how do we feed, so this is a big question, and you know, if you line up 100 allergists, you're going to get 100 different opinions about if somebody comes in, say, with cow's milk FPIs, do you avoid, how many foods do you avoid, or what do you recommend that they introduce and things along those lines. So this was adopted from actually Anna's review in 2015 that I mentioned at the beginning. So for those who have milk or soy FPIs, then they should really avoid that specific antigen, but it's debatable whether they need to avoid both of those. So some people would say you can introduce very cautiously. Others would say avoid. It's really going to be a shared decision making. But there's no reason to avoid solid foods. Also, if they're exclusively breastfeeding or if they have extensively hydrolyzed formula, they should be okay for the most part. So you can introduce those. And then really, if we think about the safe foods to go with, starting with the yellow fruits and vegetables. Why yellow fruits and vegetables? Because that's what people have written about and described so far. So that's sort of the blueprint that we're going with. And then you can go towards other types of fruits and vegetables. And then you can follow that with grains and legumes and poultry and things along those lines. So I think a big trap that a lot of people get caught into is you say, oh, the common causes described to cause FPIs include things like rice and grains and vegetables and poultry. So if you have FPIs, you have to avoid all of those. But it doesn't appear that that's how it works. So if you have FPIs to one of those, then yeah, you should avoid like, you know, similar antigens, but otherwise it's not like you're at risk to develop FPIs to all of the other foods. And hopefully that makes sense. And then this is just adopted from the international consensus guidelines that I'll refer you back to, but basically it's talking about the lower risk, moderate risk, and higher risk foods. So we want to encourage that families, you know, introduce these different foods. They can start slow and then and gain some confidence and go from there. But really, fruits and vegetables should be safe for the most part. And then we can move towards different types of grains. And then really even thinking about, especially now, early introduction of peanuts and legumes and tree nuts and things along those lines. Okay, so there are some questions that really remain unanswered. So if we have somebody with IgE food allergy, You know, we have them read labels, and we talk about precautionary labeling and trace amounts. Does the same rules apply for FPIs? We simply don't know. My guess would be probably not, especially as children get older and they tend to outgrow it and develop more tolerance. What about baked milk and egg? This seems to change the way that the antigen is introduced to the immune system, but is it different if it's an IgE-mediated food allergy versus non-IgE-mediated food allergy? And then we already talked about the similarities in foods. Do you have to avoid an entire class of foods? If you're allergic, you know, if you have FPIs to one grain, do you have to avoid all grains? What about oral food challenges? Do we need to have IV access prior to it? And then should we give steroids? So these are a lot of just questions you may receive. I don't have the right or wrong answer to any of these, but these are things that we should be thoughtful about as we communicate with families. Now, the good news is we fully expect almost all children with FPIs to develop tolerance to that food as they get older. The majority are going to develop it by school age. Rarely will they hold on to it longer than that. It's going to be variable based upon the child and the food and things along those lines. Unfortunately, the only way to determine it is really just by giving it again. And most people would recommend avoiding it for about 12 months, and then you can try again. It all depends on the age of their reaction, the severity of their reaction. There is some consideration for IgE testing, especially for cow's milk. As I mentioned, there's the idea of co-sensitization or the development of IgE allergy. We don't fully know what that looks like. I would say if you're going to do IgE testing, do it with the sort of understanding of I'm going to use the result to help indicate the way we should introduce this, whether it's a much more high-risk sort of challenge versus more of a low-risk. Of course, unless it's strongly positive, then you may have to have them avoid it. And then if they do react, the criteria for a positive challenge would be, do they have symptoms? So we would expect them to have vomiting plus minus diarrhea. And then I don't know what you do at your center, but we don't really, for most of our FPIs patients, we don't put lines in. We're not measuring blood counts, and we're not actually checking the feces or blood for any signs of a reaction either. For most of these kids, we can just reintroduce it, and they generally do quite well. Or if they do have symptoms, again, it's going to be much more mild compared to the prior reaction. Okay, so we're going to move on then. And then if you have questions, again, I have my full screen pulled up, so feel free to yell at me and we can pause. Otherwise, I'll keep going. So this is food protein-induced allergic proctocolitis. And this one is the classic story we've all had on our pediatric board exams that we all learn about. It's the initial presentation, typically early in life, almost always in the first 6 months. It has painless, bright red blood in the stool. These are blood-streaked, mucousy stools. It can occur in breastfed infants as well. Babies look fine. They may have associated colic or gassiness, but we're not going to see these infants have failure to thrive or severe symptoms that would clue us into any underlying pathology. This is an example of what the parents may come in with, with the diaper, the classic sort of looks like jelly in there. It's bright red blood. And it's most commonly going to occur to cow's milk or soy. We rarely see it in extensively hydrolyzed formulas, but you can see it in breastfed infants. And this is actually something I learned as I researched this talk, because that wasn't the classic teaching that I had, but it can be passed along in the breast milk for some infants. And you can see it for cow's milk, soy, egg, or corn. I'm not going to say that that's a common presentation, but it's something to keep in mind as well. IgE testing is going to be negative. You may see some non-specific abnormalities just based on basically the severity of the bleeding that's occurring. Now, as far as management, we just want to take it out of the diet. Now, the one thing that I see all the time, and I'm sure you have this experience with as well, is somebody is gung-ho and they say this is cow's milk-induced allergic proctocolitis, take it out of the diet. Parents come in the next day, they say they're still bleeding. Okay, well, let's change the formula again. They come in the next day, let's change the formula again and again. We need to give this a couple of days at least to sort itself out and let the intestines heal to make sure that we're not causing any more damage. But you can often go straight to soy formula, and we want to avoid the formula roulette. It does require some monitoring and support, and then rarely do we have to go straight to the extensively hydrolyzed or amino acid formulas. So we have some time to figure this out, and the reason why is because it's a relatively benign condition. So if we don't get the right formula the first time, we'll have some time to sort this out with the knowledge that we're not going to cause severe damage with ongoing symptoms over several days. So we can sort of see how kids do. Our babies do, I should say. Now, the vast majority can just reintroduce this at home. I still receive referrals that want IgE testing before they put it back in the diet around a year of age, but that's not necessary at all. And interestingly, you can actually start, you can try to introduce it back in the diet within a month or two after resolution of symptoms, but I think most of us would advocate waiting till around 12 months of age, especially when we're talking about cow's milk-induced proctocolitis, because by the time they transition to drinking whole cow's milk, they need to be a year of age anyways. And then in breastfed infants, and this is where it's sort of this nebulous condition of, a lot of them will have spontaneous resolution. So we're not quite sure if that's an association or if that's the causality or who knows what's going on there. Now, a more severe presentation is going to be food protein-induced enteropathy. This is typically going to be early on in life, almost always in the first year, especially before the first 9 months or so. And these kids just have chronic diarrhea. It doesn't get better. They just have chronic diarrhea. More than half have failure to thrive. And they can also have other symptoms that would go along with that as well. The more common foods would be cow's milk formula, but it has been described as well in soy, wheat, and egg, especially if they have multiple food allergies. And this is another one that we rarely see in exclusively breastfed infants. So if there's one thing to kind of keep in mind when you have a baby who's exclusively breastfed with concerning symptoms, it appears that it's likely only the food protein-induced allergic proctocolitis that's really high on the list of things we need to think about, at least from a non-IgE-mediated food allergy. In regards to testing, IgE tests again are negative. These kids are generally pretty sick, so they're going to be undergoing extensive evaluation and often will have biopsies that will show villus atrophy. They can see other changes as dictated on the slide as well. And then the non-specific abnormalities that you're going to see with any infant who has sort of chronic diarrhea and is not doing well. Management, identify it, diagnose it, take it out of the diet. Symptoms should resolve within a month or so. This one's going to take a little bit longer to resolve compared to the food protein-induced allergic proctocolitis. And you can really see months before the gut has fully healed. So these infants require a lot of nutritional monitoring and support. The vast majority can reintroduce it in the future. Again, we want to give them at least a month or two from symptom resolution before you try it again. And then almost all of them will outgrow it as they get older. So this is something that generally we're going to see consulted on probably in the inpatient setting, or at least they've seen a gastroenterologist before they see us. I think early in life, more severe presentation. In regards to the differential diagnosis, we always have to keep these things in mind as well. This is just a list of things you're already familiar with. So infection, of course, if they have severe reflux or if they have other anatomic abnormalities that could lead to their symptoms, especially with recurrent vomiting. Inflammatory bowel disease is pretty unusual in early infancy, but certainly we can see it. Of course, we all know about primary immune deficiencies and how failure to thrive and chronic diarrhea can go along with some of those disorders as well. Now, we'll shift gears a little bit towards the eosinophilic gastrointestinal diseases. So the most common form of EGID is eosinophilic esophagitis, and we'll talk about this one mostly for this talk. This is sort of a whole talk in itself. This is, again, one that we're increasing our understanding in regards to the pathophysiology, but I would say it's still not like we have the slam dunk, we know exactly what's going on. But it's something that we've certainly understood to a greater extent over the last few years. I love this. This was, I believe, New England Journal, a great review article on this, just talking about all the information that's been available for EOE, and the evolution of our understanding of this has been fascinating over the last 10 years, 15 years even. I liken this sort of to our how everybody's looking at the microbiome right now. So right now we have tons of data, and the microbiome seems like it's a hot topic and probably playing a causal role, and we're accumulating data in this mountain of, these associations. But at the end of the day, we still don't know what it means or how much of it's directly causal. Well, EOE is similar to that. There's a lot of associations that have been identified over the years, but how much of it is actually causal? So just things to keep in mind as you read through the literature and opinions on that. In regards to the clinical presentation, children tend not to be quite as severe as adults. It's more abdominal pain, nausea. They can have failure to thrive and recurrent vomiting. And then with adults, they're the ones who present more likely with food impaction and strictures and more severe dysphagia. But the presentation can be highly variable. Common foods, we've come really not full circle per se, and we'll talk more about the new guidelines in regards to elimination diets. But we used to recommend, I guess the debate is EOE a food allergy? Or is EOE is it an inflammatory condition associated with ingestion of specific foods? And I think you're going to hear debate about that. But we do know that foods are definitely implicated in the vast majority of people who have EOE, especially in children. And milk is the most common one associated with at least 50% of cases. We also see it more likely with wheat and also egg as well. In regards to the diagnosis, you need the elements. So you really need to have symptoms suggestive for it. Hopefully people aren't just doing blind biopsies and diagnosing EoE in somebody who's asymptomatic. You need to have at least a clinical presentation consistent with that. You need to have evidence of elevated eosinophils. We still use the cutoff of 15 EOs per high-powered field. And then ideally, they've been treated with a proton pump inhibitor prior to biopsy, although we'll talk about the different phenotypes here in a second. And then different things have been tried over the years, and it makes sense because we say EoE seems to be associated with an immune response to food, so let's use the common, you know, food immune response testing that we have, which would include skin prick or serologic ID testing, as well as patch tests. Well, it turns out they may not have the greatest utility in actually identifying the specific food that may be causal for EoE, and we may actually have better ways of identifying foods and removing them from the diet, at least on a trial elimination basis. The new international guidelines were published last year, and this was a group that got together and really talked through the different phenotypes, and I love this because this was really the first attempt to acknowledge the heterogeneity of EoE, and this is very similar to asthma, and we're all familiar with the different phenotypes and endotypes of asthma. We're going to see the same thing here with EoE. It's just a matter of really getting a broader sense of what this looks like and trying to tease it out and identify it. And really what they talked about was the same criteria for the most part. But there's more of a PPI responsive EoE and just some alterations in the definitions that we use. In regards to endoscopic findings, it can be completely normal, especially in more mild presentations. But from a macroscopic standpoint, we're all familiar with the rings that you can see or furrowing. You can see swelling and edema or strictures and things along those lines. Now, we always want to advocate for taking multiple biopsies from different sites. Ideally, they're going to be in the proximal esophagus and distal esophagus, as well as in the middle part of it as well. Obviously, if you see inflammation when you're down there looking through the camera, we want to get biopsies from those sites as well. And I'll just reiterate, just because you have eosinophils there doesn't mean you have eosinophilic esophagitis. There are a lot of conditions associated with finding eosinophils in the esophagus where they technically don't belong, especially if you have reflux, if you have other types of eosinophilic gastrointestinal diseases. Any cause of systemic eosinophilia can cause eosinophils to go there as well, including autoimmune disorders, vasculitis, if you're having allergic reactions, connective tissue disorders, things along those lines. As far as management, it's really going to be all over the place and very individualized, but there's some certain central tenets that we all should sort of think about at least. So this focuses on dietary elimination, therapy with proton pump inhibitors, and then the use of topical corticosteroids. And there's sort of a laddered approach you can take, and I would say that it depends upon really the severity of clinical presentation as well as the desires of the family. A lot of families would much rather try topical therapy with daily swallowed corticosteroids compared with eliminating foods from their diet. But this is a little bit of an older review now that kind of walks through it, and I'll talk about the new guidelines we're going to publish soon here in a second. In regards to the approach to dietary therapy, again, it really requires communication. I think we need to acknowledge that if we're going to do six food elimination diets, one, not everybody has to do that. Two, these are really hard to follow. And what are we treating here? So for somebody who has symptoms once every 6 months, but they have severe eosinophilia on their biopsies, do we really want to put them through a six food elimination diet that can have its own consequences as well, especially in regards to quality of life? So I think it really does take an individualized approach. This was a nice review that really looked at the comparisons of using various elemental diets. So we have the six food elimination diet, the four food elimination diet, you can eliminate two foods, allergen tested diets, and then when it comes to just dairy elimination. So it really goes again with what's the likelihood that a specific food is actually causing symptoms. Just because people in the past have taken the approach of looking at six foods or four foods or whatever combination of foods they use to look at a cohort of patients, it doesn't mean that that necessarily applies to that patient that's sitting in your office at that moment. So just taking a thoughtful approach to this with shared decision making, I think is a benefit to all. Now, in regards to prognosis, this is variable. It depends upon a lot of things, including the severity of symptoms, the findings on endoscopy, age of presentation. We definitely want to advocate for long-term monitoring of all patients, even those that become asymptomatic after a few months or after a year or two. And then really the area of controversy, and this is something we talked about in developing the guidelines, because when you look at the research, are we treating towards histologic improvement or are we treating towards symptomatic improvement? And you're going to hear people on both ends of this, and I don't have the right answer, and I would say it's probably more individualized. Do we need to perform endoscopy and biopsy on every single patient every single time we do an intervention to see if it actually had an impact, or can we get away with more symptomatic monitoring? And I would say it's highly variable, and it's going to be case dependent. So I don't think it's a one size fits all at this point. And then really, when we think about maintenance therapy, this is going to be more towards those truly refractory cases or severe cases that we're going to worry about stricture development as they get older and things along those lines. Okay, so I don't know if any of you read this, but this was out for public comments, which has since closed, and I do expect this to be published hopefully in the next 6 months or so. This was a joint approach from the AGA as well as the Joint Task Force to develop new practice parameters, and we use the GRADE approach. So there's no more, at least for this one and several others we're working on, we're not going to use a categorizing evidence as level A, B, C, D, or level of evidence of 1, 2, 3. It's really more taking a look at the evidence overall, asking more specific questions, and then trying to grade the strength of the science to support it, or the evidence, as well as the strength of the recommendation. And I'll give you a sense. So these are some of the questions. I think we answered 15 different questions. Question 1, should proton pump inhibitors be used in patients with esophageal eosinophilia? So we suggest using proton pump inhibition over no treatment. So it's very specific how this is worded. So if you're going to basically say, should we use it at all, then yes, we should use it as opposed to doing nothing. And this is a conditional recommendation based upon very low quality evidence. And you'd say, how can that be when PPI use is in all the guidelines that we use and it just makes intuitive sense? Well, when you actually go through the evidence and the data, it doesn't hold up that great, and it's a lot because the endpoints are moving targets and they're not always matched up with each other. So there's a lot of factors that go into why we put these different strengths on the recommendations and evidence. But this is ultimately the consensus statement is the most impactful. Question 2, should topical glucocorticosteroids be used in patients with the EoE? In patients with the EoE, we recommend using that over no treatment. It's not head-to-head. We're not going to find very many studies or certainly not high quality evidence saying, do we use topical corticosteroids compared with dietary elimination or topical corticosteroids compared with PPIs? Question 3, should systemic glucocorticoids be used? And in this one, we suggest using topical rather than oral glucocorticosteroids. And this one really was to address the more common use we learned from our GI colleagues in adult populations. So if we need to use systemic glucocorticoids, we want to use a trial of topical first. Additional questions, I'm not going to go through them all, this will be the last one I go through. Should an elemental diet be used? And if you look at this, we put a comment on here as well. So in patients, we do suggest using elemental diet over no treatment. So again, not in comparison to swallowed corticosteroids, but compared to no treatment at all, it would be more beneficial to use an elemental diet. However, we want to make sure that everybody who reads the practice parameters identifies that patients may put a higher value on treatment as opposed to dietary avoidance and things along those lines. Question 5, should an empiric food elimination diet be used in patients with EoE? And then this one again, we suggest an empiric 6 food elimination over no treatment, conditional recommendation, low quality evidence, similar comment as well. And then question 6 is, should allergy-based testing be used for the purpose of identifying food triggers? And again, this one is a conditional recommendation, very low quality evidence to use allergy testing-based elimination diet, but again, compared to over no treatment. Not compared to the empiric 6 food or elemental diets. So hopefully that makes sense. It's a long document. There's a lot in the technical report that goes through this. Additional questions really look at things such as using montelukast or using anti-leukotriene 5 modalities to treat it, or even omalizumab and things along those lines. And I can just tell you right now that the evidence doesn't really support using any of those agents in the treatment of EoE. Okay, so we're going to switch gears to contact dermatitis. And we know that various foods can cause rashes through various forms of contact. And also systemic contact dermatitis has been described in a subset of patients as well. Now, the clinical presentation is typically going to be contact dermatitis. So you're going to have rashes. So you can have external exposure through the skin. And then rarely ingestion can cause either localized flares at sites of previous dermatitis or more of a widespread generalized distribution as well. And the timing of onset can be highly variable in regards to that. Things to think about, is this an irritation or more of an allergic reaction? You can also have contact urticaria. Is this more of a product of the actual antigen itself being very good at liberating histamine, such as, say, strawberries or tomatoes or cinnamon in young infants? Or is this more of a reflection of what's going on with the patient in somebody who has chronic urticaria and it's more coincidental? Of course, you can also have things such as photoallergic contact dermatitis or phototoxic as well. And this is some more classic examples of what this would look like. So if it's happening right around the lips in a more of a perioral distribution, that's going to be more of the erythematous sort of papular lesions that you're going to see. You can see it on the hands for people who are handling different foods at different times. Always want to worry about in adults if they're having symptoms on their hands specifically, what are they working with, whether it's at home, during food preparation or for hobbies or for their occupation as well. So really, what's the distribution? And then going from there, teasing back to what are the likely exposures. Of course, patch testing can be useful for more of the contact dermatitis, which is associated more with the delayed T cell responses. And you can do patch testing for essentially anything. Just depends upon finding a non-irritant concentration, which isn't always easy for foods. In regards to management, it's identifying it, diagnosing it, and avoiding the offending allergen. For suspected systemic reactions, again, this is pretty rare that you're going to say, I'm eating small amounts of a food that's causing a delayed type hypersensitivity response causing systemic generalized rashes, but you may need to avoid it for a month or two, and then really try it again to see if symptoms return. But of course, you have to go through the differential, make sure you're not missing anything else that may be more likely cause as well. In regards to these rare cases, the most common ones that we're going to read about will be balsam of Peru, which can be a mixture of different allergens. It's a common cause of fragrance dermatitis, and you can find this in a wide variety of foods, some which would be, you know, less likely to be allergenic. So patients coming in saying, I'm convinced that I'm allergic to spices and, you know, liqueurs and things like that, you may want to think about this. And then, of course, with nickel, it has been reported in patients with severe nickel dermatitis that ingestion of it, and nickel's often found in soil. So you can find it in a variety of foods, including wheat and beans and lentils and peas and canned foods as well, because if there's nickel in the can, you need to worry about that as well. Now, I'm going to finish up with, I think, what is a great example of a couple of different things, including one would be the misconceptions surrounding causality and, you know, some of these food allergen-induced conditions. And this goes back to really something that happened in Cleveland where I did my fellowship, but this preceded my time there. So I'm sure you're all familiar in the room of toxic black mold and how scary this is and mold treatment centers of America, and you get consults to look at all this stuff. Well, it's interesting because a lot of it originated here. And there was a small cohort of infants living around Cleveland who developed severe respiratory symptoms and, in fact, bleeding inside their lungs. And they went inside the homes of these infants who didn't live in necessarily the highest quality housing at the time, and they found mold and the dreaded Stachybotrys, which causes the black mold that we all see growing on drywall and in corners and bathrooms and things like that. And they said, lo and behold, it must be due to the inhalation of mold. And we saw these really scary testimonials from parents saying it's really scary that breathing in toxic mold could cause your baby to lose his life, whose eight-week-old son was sick, and to think there was a chance I could have lost him. Well, this is where toxic mold got its bad name. Well, guess what? It had nothing to do with mold at all. In fact, the CDC went back and they did an extensive analysis, and they concluded that the pulmonary hemorrhage and hemosiderosis that was identified in these infants was not due to the mold. Well, guess which one took shape? The belief that toxic mold can cause severe systemic illness through causal exposures, or the fact that the CDC went back in. I'll ask you a follow-up question. Which one has taken a greater hold, the fact that Andrew Wakefield fraudulently said the MMR causes autism, or the fact that he was disproven? So this is where we get a lot of our misconceptions. Well, interestingly, a lot of these cases actually, it was due to Heiner syndrome. So this is something very rare. I'd be shocked if anybody in your room over there has seen it. I've never seen this. It's really on a case report level. But this is young infants and toddlers diagnosed in the first few years of life, all fed cow's milk formula from birth, and then went on to continue to ingest dairy. And they had chronic respiratory symptoms with pulmonary infiltrates. They had precipitating antibodies to cow's milk. And they had evidence of hemosiderosis. And then when you take milk out of the diet, they had clinical and radiologic improvement. So this is more of a board-style question, but something to kind of keep in mind. But I just like to use that sort of fun case to really walk through as we wrap things up here about some of the misconceptions that surround these conditions. So as I conclude, and we have time for questions, I'm happy to answer anything. Non-IgE food allergies typically present with gastrointestinal manifestations. So if they're non-GI symptoms, I would start thinking other ways, but always keep these things in the back of your mind. Start with the history, pretest probability that these conditions may be present, and then really have a full understanding of what our tests can and can't diagnose at this point. And then really thinking through shared decision making in regards to what foods are you going to avoid, when do you want to reintroduce them. It's not, oh, I think you're allergic to this, have a nice life. It's, let's take this out of the diet for a pre-specified period of time. Let's take careful notation if symptoms improve or not. If they do improve, let's try introducing it again at some point in the future and see if symptoms come back again. And I think if we take that consistent approach with all these patients, we're going to ultimately come to the proper diagnosis and the best management for everybody. And with that, I'm happy to take any questions.